Alright, last time we sort of gave an overview of everything that we're going to cover in the course for the most part. I didn't talk about jQuery, but we'll talk about that when we get to it. We talked largely about client-side scripting, server-side scripting, and then we mentioned AJAX. Let's review client and server-side scripting, then we'll have another brief word about AJAX. Think of it this way. We're going to start with server-side scripting. Server-side scripting is responsible for providing content. And we can amend that a little bit by saying that providing dynamic content. Again, dynamic meaning that is changing based on something. The opposite of that would be static. If the server was providing only static content, there would be no need to do it with server-side scripting. You could just plain have old-fashioned HTML pages. If everything was static, just have an HTML page. All right. The way the web is now, however, plain old static web pages really don't cut it. They don't provide the functionality that people expect from a website. So therefore, most sites contain at least some aspect of server-side scripting. And it provides content that's dynamic. Now, I say provide content. In the case of conventional web pages, it creates a web page. That's conventional web pages. In the case of AJAX web pages, it provides a piece of data that can be used to refresh a page without completely reloading. All right. Now, what do I mean when I say dynamic? Again, we said changing based on something. What is the something that it's based on? And again, that can be like almost anything you can imagine. All right, it could be based on who you are. In other words, what credentials you supplied when you logged on. So your Canvas page looks different than mine. Can be based on geographically where you are. Two people in different parts of the country did searches for restaurants, they'd get different results. All right. Could be based on your platform that you're working on. If two people looked for software and one was on a Mac and one was on a PC, the search results are going to be different. It can be based on, and again, many of these examples I'm thinking of Google because that's a pretty obvious one, right? Even some subtle things, like what you have searched for before, all right? I'll give a great example. Don Cherry. Who's ever heard of Don Cherry? All right? No hockey fans in here then, huh? Or no jazz fans, all right? There's a jazz musician named Don Cherry. There's also a very famous hockey announcer in Canada called Don Cherry. And if you are a hockey fan and you have a lot of searches for hockey in your history and you search for Don Cherry, you're going to see the hockey guy. If you have a lot of music searches in your history and search for Don Cherry, you're going to see the jazz guy. All right. So all those things go into Google search results. And I'm mentioning Google, but it could be any other sort of thing. You know, your Amazon recommendations are based on sort of your history, right? What you've purchased before, and so on. It was always great back in the old days when I would buy, like, presents for my kids on there, because it'd be like, my recommendations would contain music that I like and music my kids like. So I'd have, you know, Miles Davis, John Coltrane, and the Backstreet Boys, or something like that on the list. This, by the way, in some respects, and again, I judiciously avoid talking politics in this class, But actually, there's some implications about how Google does its search. It shows you what you have searched for before. What does that mean? That means if you search for topics and you have a particular political alignment and you continually search for certain kinds of politically oriented material, you will get more of that when you search. All right. That means that you are less likely to see views different than your own. All right. And some people consider that dangerous if you're not exposed to views different than your own, because then you only believe what you believe, and you'll never look at things a different way and possibly change your mind. All right. I think that was as safe a way as I could put that without speaking. And I mean, it works whatever end of the political spectrum you're on, right? If you're only seeing information from people that you agree with, you know, you're sort of in a silo and you're never going to expand your views. But anyhow, that's another topic for another day and probably another class. All right, the point is that server-side scripting provides dynamic content based on any number of different factors. What does client-side scripting do? Client-side scripting, if I was going to summarize it in one word, and again, this is a very general statement, all right? We can find examples of server-side scripting that don't really fit this mold, but for the most part, server-side scripting is about interactivity. When I talk about interactivity, what I mean is you do something and the page responds somehow, all right? And interactivity, specifically, without loading a new page. So I'm not talking about interactivity like you click on a link and you go somewhere else. All right, I suppose, strictly speaking, that's interactivity, but that's not the kind of stuff we're talking about here. We're talking about the things like on the ESPN menu, where you put your mouse over something and a submenu appears. All right. You click on a thumbnail on an image gallery, and a larger version of the picture appears. All right. Those kinds of things. Those happen without reloading a brand new page. How do you know it happens without reloading a new page? Well, good question. You can tell by looking at the status bar. If the status bar flickers saying that it's loading a new page, you can tell it's loading a page. You can tell generally if the page sort of visibly refreshes, like wipes clean and starts over, all right? And you could sometimes tell by the immediacy of it. If it happens instantaneously, it's probably running on your machine, right? Because remember, my famous diagram, client, internet, server. Even on a very fast internet connection with a very fast server, sending a request through the internet to a server and getting a response back takes far more time than code that actually has been already loaded on the web page, on the browser, and is running right on the machine that is viewing the web page. All right, the code has already been downloaded. It's sitting there. There's no round trip through the internet required. Now, again, with AJAX, the client side requests a piece of data and redisplays it on the page. The classic example of AJAX is what we showed last time with Google, whereas you're typing in, you see the top four selections that match what you've typed in so far. All right, so if you typed in P, you would see the top four selections start with P. If you type PH, you'd see the top four selections start with PH. PHP, the top four that start with PHP. All right. You can sort of tell that something funny is going on there because it's happening immediately, and yet it's getting dynamic content. All right. Let's see. Anything else about this? I don't think so. All right. Let's look back at what's on a web page. web page. So this is assuming it's already on the client. The discussion from here on in is going to be talking, today at least, is going to be talking about client-side scripting. So what's on a web page that gets delivered to the client? Generally speaking, three things. HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. I'm going to assume right now that we don't know a lot about the JavaScript aspect of it. You might know a little bit, but that's really what we're talking about in this class. So we're going to move on to this. Let's first sort of review these other two things. What does HTML provide on a web page? It provides the content. And so we're talking about the text that's on a page, the headings that are on a page, the links that are on the page, the images that are on the page, multimedia content, all that sort of stuff. All of that is in the HTML. All right. If we wanted to maybe speak more precisely, we could say that an HTML page is a collection of elements. And by elements, I pretty much mean tags, right? You know, I could talk about the link element, or the image element, or the nav element. I'm talking about the nav tag, the nav whatever, all right? These elements have attributes. Attributes, another word for attributes, would be like characteristics. These elements have characteristics. So for example, a characteristic of an element, a characteristic of an image element might be the specific image file that it's displaying. That's a characteristic of it, right? You have an image tag, that's an attribute of it, what specific image we're saying. Alright? A characteristic of a nav element might be a link that's included in it, all right? The content of that element, all right? What tags are inside of that? That's another, I guess that's not really an attribute, that's more of content, but again, that's another stuff that elements have. They have attributes and then they have their content. So for example, in a nav tag, you might have a list, an unordered list, and the content of that list may be a series of three or four links. Alright? Now some of the attributes are part of the HTML, like the source attribute of an image tag, or the href attribute of a link tag. In addition to these attributes, these CSS elements have style. Let's back up for 1 second. These elements are typically organized into a structure. So for example, a nav has a list of links. A section might have headings and paragraphs and so on. These HTML links also have style attributes. And these style attributes are found in CSS. And they control the actual look of the page. So things like color, font, etc. Also things like the position on the page. You can use CSS to put something in a particular spot on the page. Alright. Now where does JavaScript come in? JavaScript comes in because it allows interactivity. So you do something and the page responds. The page responds to change either the content content or the appearance of the page. How does that happen? Well, that happens by changing these things. Changing either the content or the style of the different elements on the page. How does it do it? Well, how would you do it if you were doing it manually? Right? For example, if you had a page that was, or if you had a thing on your page, a section on your page that was yellow, and you wanted to make it red, how would you go and do that? Well, you'd have CSS on your page that said that that section was yellow. All right? You would go into the style attribute and change the style attribute from yellow to red. That's how you would change it if you were doing it manually. All right? Well, how does JavaScript do it? Well, you write code to do that very thing. You do code to do the same thing that you do manually. All right? Yeah, that's one of them easier said than done, right? I mean, yeah, but do keep in mind, in a nutshell, that's what you're doing. You're doing the same thing that you would do if you were going to change it manually, except you're writing code to do that. All right? And your code is going to fire off based on the user doing something. All right. Now the recipe for JavaScript is like this. Most JavaScript, and again, speaking in generalizations, involves one, a user event that gets the ball rolling. The user clicks on something, for example. So it's an obvious example of that. Or the user puts their mouse over something. All right, so the user does something. You then have JavaScript code to point to the things you want to change. All right. So you want to change the style of something? You know how to do it manually. You have to write code to do that. So the first step in writing the code to do that is to point to the thing that you want to change. And then finally, you write JavaScript code to actually change the attributes, style, or content of the elements. If some of the stuff isn't clear, let's see an actual example of it. And I hope that will make things clear. I just want to point, sort of, make a roadmap of where we're going to. So you understand conceptually what it is we're going to do. We're going to go over some actual concrete examples. All right. And to start off, we're going to go over some goofy examples. All right. Part of the reason I go over goofy examples is because they're simple to do, right? I can write them in a minute or two. But part of the reason I do it is to indicate the power of JavaScript. With JavaScript, anything that you can code in HTML, you can write JavaScript to code as well. So how would I make the text on the page gigantic and yellow? Well, I know how to do that via CSS. Well, we're going to explore how to do that dynamically with JavaScript, or interactively with JavaScript. So let's look at a couple examples. There's multiple computers here, so I can try to guess which mouse to use. Just in the interest of time, I'm starting to type it in. I don't know where the projector is. Can you see? You're welcome to turn off the lights if you'd rather. I'm going to make a real simple web page. So again, this right now is just HTML. Right? So all it is content. Alright, there's no styling at all. Which doesn't mean that the page isn't going to have an appearance, right? I mean, there's defaults that are built into the browser, alright, for things like the fact that the background of the page is going to be white, the text is going to be black, and the font will probably be Times New Roman, and the font will be a certain size. All those things are aspects of the appearance, but we haven't done anything with that, so therefore we're going to get the browser defaults. So I'm going to save this. Continue to use external CSS files. This is a case where I'm not practicing what I preach, all right? But I'm not doing it just because I'm lazy. I'm doing it because I think it's easier to explain if you can view the CSS and the HTML all at the same time. All right. Now, just for a laugh, not that it's very funny, I'm going to put a second section on this page. And I'm going to go in here and I'm going to put style. And I'm going to make the background color of my sections yellow. Now we should all know what that does, right? With style rules, you have two pieces. You have the selector and then you have the attributes. The selector defines what gets that particular rule. Alright? So in this case, the section tag gets that rule. Notice there's nothing before the word section. We'll see examples later on where there will be a dot and there will be a pound sign in front of those things, which means something else. The dot means it's a class name. The pound sign means it's an ID. So this simply says that every section on my page I want to change to have a background color of yellow. Alright? Every section tag on this page, there's two of them, I want to make the background color yellow. Alright? So I'm going to save this again. And I'm going to view it. And here we go. There's my two sections, and the background is yellow. Alright. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put some interactivity on the page, all right? I'm going to put some interactivity to change each of the sections to have a different background color, all right? So how am I going to do that? first of all, I'm going to put a button on the page. Now, this is not a submit button. Remember, a submit button makes a request to the server. We don't want to make a request to the server. We simply want to invoke some JavaScript. So we're going to use a button to do that. Okay. So I've input type equals button. Value equals change color. Now, I'm going to put on click. On click is a user event, right? It's one of the things that the user can do to interact with an element on the page. You can associate with any element on the page a series of user events. There's actually a couple ways you can do that. This is the most straightforward. We might explore some of the other ways that you can do this later on in the class. But right now, we're going to put an onClick event on there. That means when the user clicks on that button, we want something to happen. All right? And we want something to happen without going back to the server. In other words, we want some JavaScript to happen. All right? So this onClick on a button will invoke some JavaScript. All right? Now, what JavaScript do we want to invoke? We want to invoke a statement to change this section from yellow to red, let's say. All right? We want to change this first section from yellow to red. Now, how would we do that if we were to do this manually? If I wanted to manually code this section so that when the page loaded initially, the top section was yellow and the bottom section was red. What would we do?
Give an ID to the second section.
Yeah, we'd give an ID either to the first or the second section, depending on which one we want to change. Probably would give an ID to both. Yeah. All right. Why do we give an ID? What's the advantage of giving an ID? Right, to single it out. An ID ought to be unique on a page. What do I mean by unique? In other words, there's only one thing that has a given ID. All right? That way we can point to that specific thing. So I'm going to go in and I'm going to make the change now, and then I'm going to actually undo the change. All right? So I could put an ID here. ID equals first. And I could say pound sign first. The pound sign means it's not an HTML tag. It is a ID. So anything that has an ID of pound sign first, we could make the background color red. And there we go. Oh. I forgot to close my input tag, so that confused it. There we go. All right. So now we have the top one red and the bottom one yellow. All right. So that's how we do it manually. Would use an ID to point to the specific thing that we want to change, and would write a CSS rule to say, hey, that specific thing, I want to change to have a background color of red. All right? So I'm going to get rid of that now. JavaScript to do that. Well, essentially the same way. I have to point to the element that I want to change, and I have to write the JavaScript instruction that will change the background color from yellow to red. All right? So how do we do that? Well, In JavaScript, there's a thing called the DOM. The DOM stands for the document, the word DOM, or the acronym DOM, stands for Document Object Model. What that is that's a method of pointing to the different pieces of content, the different elements in the document, the objects in the document. So one statement that you are going to see a million times in this class, we'll get to in a minute, all right? Now, there's a few ways that I could refer to this. I could say it's the first section tag on the page. But probably the best way to refer to a specific element on the page is to use its ID. So the statement that we're going to use a lot of times in this class is document get element by ID. And then we're going to put in the parentheses the ID. Let's analyze what this does. Document means it's somewhere on the web page. All right? Well, where else would it be? Well, you can actually write JavaScript code to control a pop-up window, a window that you pop up. So it might not actually be this page, but it might be in a page that this page popped up. All right? So document, however, means it's somewhere on this web page. Get element by ID means the thing that we're going to that we're interested in, and the thing that we're going to change is the thing on the page that has an ID of whatever we have listed in here. In this case, first. All right. That's why it's important that these IDs are unique, right? Because we want to point to a specific thing on the page and say change that. All right. Now again, that's for this example. In other examples, we might want to change every section, in which case we'd have a different kind of code for that. All right? But in this case, I want to find that one thing on the page, and I want to change something about it. Now, what do I want to change about that thing on the page? I want to change its style. So I'm going to say dot style. Alright. What about the style do I want to change? I want to change the background color. Alright. Now here's one little quirk of JavaScript versus CSS. Notice the slight difference in spelling for the word background color. In CSS, it's background dash color. In JavaScript, it's background color with no dash, but the C is capitalized. So anytime you have an attribute in CSS that has a dash in it, when you use that attribute in JavaScript, you omit the dash and just capitalize the first letter of the next word. So instead of background dash color, it would be background capital C color. Instead of font dash size, it would be font capital S size. All right. What do I want to change it to? Well, what would I type in if I was going to change it? Up here, I'd type in red. We're going to try this, make sure it works, all right? Make sure I didn't typo or something. Make sure it works, and then we're going to come back and talk about some aspects of this, all right? Why don't I go save it? Hit refresh. Here's a paragraph. I click on the button, and there, it changed it to red. Yay. All right. By the way, something I'll probably say a million times in this class is I'm a big fan of doing things a little bit at a time instead of trying to do everything at once. Notice how I even coded this. I mean, it's so ingrained in how I do things that even without thinking about it, I put in the HTML first, ran it, make sure it looked the way that I wanted it to look. I put in the CSS next. I ran it, make sure it looked the way that I wanted to. Then I put in the JavaScript, ran it, make sure it worked the way I wanted it to. I could have typed the whole thing in, right? And I probably would have got this right because I've been doing this a million years, right? On the other hand, I possibly could have a problem with it. And the advantage of doing it a little bit at a time is if it worked a minute ago and it doesn't work now, then chances are it's like the last thing that you changed. So instead of looking throughout all your code, you're only looking at maybe a handful of lines. Okay, a few things to note. All right, number one, the case of these things is important. All right, so notice the way these case things work. I've heard some people call this camel case because the first letter is low and then each subsequent word is capitalized. So like you have bumps in the word. So the word document is lowercase. There's only one word in that. Get element by ID, the G in get is lowercase because it's the first word in a phrase. The E is capitalized, the B is capitalized, and the I. Alright? Likewise, style. There's only one word, so it's style. Background color, the word background is lowercase, but the word color is uppercase. Yes?
If you were doing that to a div, would you still put ID or would you put div?
No, you'd always use ID. You would just make sure that the div had an ID on it.
Okay.
Right. So this ID works on anything that has an ID. In other words, if we change this to a div, it would work the exact same one. This uses what's called dot notation. And if you've done any other programming, you've probably seen dot notation. What is dot notation? Well, it's sort of a way of sort of like zooming in on a particular thing. So you start broad, and then you get narrower and narrower and narrower. Document means, hey, we're looking at something on this page. All right, that's pretty broad, right? Get element by ID first means what we're interested in on this page is the thing that has an ID of first. So we've zoomed in. We're not looking at the entire page now. We're looking just at that one thing, that one element that has an ID of first. What about that thing are we interested in? We're interested in the style of it. All right? Finally, what about the style are we interested in? We're interested in the background color. So we've zoomed in from we're interested in something on this page to something on that particular element to what about that element, its style, to what about its style, we're interested in the background color. So we've zoomed in. So anytime you see dot notation, you're like zooming in on something. All right? You're starting off broad, something on this page. This particular thing on this page, this particular aspect of it, this particular value. The last thing that I want to note is the use of the quotes here. All right? Notice that my onClick event, onClick equals, starts and ends with double quotes. All right? Inside those double quotes are single quotes. The reason for that is this. If I were to use double quotes in here, the browser would think that this is a whole onClick event. Because it would see the starting quote, it would see the ending quote, and think, oh, I'm done. And it wouldn't know what to do with this stuff. It would just think that the whole thing would be that. And obviously that's not valid. Alright? So it wouldn't work. Alright? What do we put in quotes? Well, we put in the quote specific values of things. So document is, you know, a reserved word. All right? It's always going to be document, not in quotes. GetElementById is a function. This function accepts an argument. In other words, a specific value of the ID that we're interested in. All right? In that case, we're interested in first. Style is, again, a reserved word. Background color is a reserved word. What specific value are we changing the color to? Red. And therefore, it's enclosed in quotes. All right. Now, I almost wish I could turn the projector off for a second, but I don't want to go through the time of turning it off and turning it back on. So I'm going to sabotage my page. All right? I'm going to make an error. All right. What's wrong with that? Well, again, ID should be capital I, lowercase d, because the first letter of the word is capitalized, the next letter is lowercase. So that's wrong, as incorrect. So, again, JavaScript is case sensitive. Therefore, this is not going to work. It isn't like HTML, where HTML you could have a lowercase tag or an uppercase tag, and it really doesn't matter. All right. This is case sensitive, so you need to be real careful about this. What I want to do is I want to look at how you troubleshoot this. Because troubleshooting JavaScript is something that's very, very, very important. All right? And we'll talk probably about a couple of different ways to troubleshoot the code. All right? But it's very important because I'll tell you what the least effective way of troubleshooting code is. And that is simply staring at it until the right answer jumps into your head. All right? You know, the funny thing is a lot of people do that. Even relatively experienced developers. They think that they're just not looking hard enough, so they furrow their brow and they look harder. All right? The second favorite debugging technique is to just randomly trying typing different things in until something works. All right? That's not also not effective because you can randomly type a whole bunch of stuff before you happen to hit on the right code. So it's better to have a systematic approach. And the browser will let you know what it has trouble with. But it doesn't necessarily let you know in very clear language. So I've put that error on this page. We know what the problem is, that the D is uppercase. Let's go and run this page. All right. And let's try to troubleshoot it. We click change color and nothing happened. All right. Now, why did nothing happen? Well, we know, right? But if we didn't know, how would we figure it out? Well, you can go and click. Now, this is in Google Chrome. Different browsers have different methods for doing this, all right? And if you're running it on a browser and if you're running it on Firefox, for example, and Internet Explorer, I can go over with you how to troubleshoot on those platforms. But in Google, if I go here under More Tools, there's a thing called Developer Tools. And there is a thing called the console. The console is where errors are displayed. So I click over to the console, and it says, uncaught type error. Document get element by ID is not a function. And it tells me what line it occurred in. Line 19 of example.html, which is this code right here, this line right here. All right. So, it gave us a hint where the problem is. Well, in this case, it's pretty obvious, right? Because we only have one line of JavaScript in the whole thing. So, of course, we know it's this line. But, if you're working on a larger client-side scripting issue, then knowing the specific line that gives you a problem is very beneficial. Because if you have 200 lines of JavaScript, it's nice to know which of the 200 lines there is actually the error in, so you don't have to guess. about that. So it gave us a hint by telling us getElementById is not a function. Alright? It would be nice if it told you, hey, I think you mean getElementById with a lowercase d, but it doesn't. But at the very least, it told me it didn't recognize this. And then you can apply a thought process to say, well, if it didn't recognize this, what could be wrong? And the typical problems are either misspelling, like maybe I typoed and forgot the E or something like that, or capitalization, all right? Or I just made up a function, you know, that isn't valid. I typed in something just totally off the wall because I thought that was the name of the function. But it told us that this is not right. So we can, that really narrows it down. We know that at least the current problem isn't any of this stuff. That the problem is in this phrase. And so we can look at things like, is it misspelled? Did I get the function wrong? Or is it capitalized incorrectly? And now I know, hey, is capitalized incorrectly? I can go in and actually go and change it. All right? And get it back to normal. Refresh. And we're back in business. And if we look at the console again, we'll see that there are no errors this time. All right, it worked. So right off the bat, it's important to take a systematic approach and look at the messages that the browser gives you. All right? It's very difficult to tell, again, especially when you get into where you have multiple lines of JavaScript. It's very difficult to determine exactly what went wrong. All right. Well, that's JavaScript for you. I guess we'll take the next few weeks off, and we'll meet up. No, just kidding. This is the basics of JavaScript. This is like the fundamental principles of what JavaScript is about. We have user events. All right. Now, there's a whole bunch of other user events, too. You can Google them, and we'll explore them in upcoming classes as we do things. All right? Right now, we can look for JavaScript events and see a list of some of them. Common HTML events, on change, on click, on mouse over, and so on. All right? So it gives us... And if you think about it, it's, you know, it makes sense. It's the way the user can interact with it. You know, if any of you are on Twitter, as you type in, it shows you a countdown of how many characters you have left. Well, that's clearly a JavaScript event, right? In other words, as you press a key, something happens. So we'll learn more user events. We'll learn more about the attributes that we can change. And more importantly, we'll learn, instead of just simple one-liner changes, we'll learn how to write more extensive changes. JavaScript that involves multiple statements instead of just one. All right. So more user events, more attributes to change, and then more involve more complex scripting. Things such as validation. In other words, you have a form and you want to validate it to make sure that the data is accurate. Well, we can write JavaScript code to do that. All right. We'll also take a look at your lab, too, and talk about what you would need to do to solve that. All right. Any questions now? All right. See you over in lab. Typically, what I will do is I will walk over to lab. I'll unlock the lab. I'll come here and make sure I have downloaded the video so I can upload it.